So desalination, a topic that I think most of you in the audience, I know a number of you are very familiar with. Did a little quick look this morning. In 2009, as referenced in the California Water Plan, there were 26 desalination facilities operating in California to provide water to urban agencies. And in total, they provided about 84,000 acre feet per year of supply to those urban agencies. And since then, there's been a number of desal plants that have come online that have near doubled the capacity. And one of those projects that we'll talk a little bit about today is the facility down in Carlsbad in San Diego. So desal is an important part of water supply portfolios for agencies throughout California. And it's growing. It has a lot of benefits, but a lot of critics or controversy as well. On the benefits side, it provides a lot of increased reliability during dry years. It's something that you can flip a switch and turn on and have it there if you need it. It also provides a reduction in vulnerability associated with the need to convey water long distances. You typically build your desal facilities relatively close to the area where the water's being used. So those are benefits, but on the concern side, there are receiving water impacts that cause a lot of concern to the environmental community. And also, it's very energy intensive, and as a result, it's very expensive, and hence, the Water Energy Nexus Conference and the reason for speaking about this today. I can say from personal experience, going through a 5 or 6 year long-term water supply planning process, that desal is second in controversy only to building new dams or enlarging dams on rivers. So that ought to give you a sense for how hard it is to move a desal project forward. Every project that I've heard of has lawsuits involved along the way, and it takes a long, long time. So here today, we have a panel of very seasoned experts that provide for us the full spectrum of expertise on desal. We have expertise in planning, permitting, technical expertise, environmental expertise, and we also have construction and finance expertise at the table. First, Ron Davis here is the executive director of Cal Desal. He's been in that role for about 2.5 years. Before that, he served as the legislative director for Aqua, and then a long history with the Santa Clara Valley Water District and the California Municipal Utilities Association. We also have with us Dr. Val Frankel. He is the technical expert in the group, director of membrane technologies for the consulting firm Arcadis. He has expertise, has written over 100 publications on the areas of water and wastewater treatment, desalination, and salinity management. We also have Dr. Peter Glick, who is a world-renowned expert, innovator, and communicator on water and climate issues. His work has redefined water from the realm of engineers to the world of social justice, sustainability, human rights, and integrated thinking, and has a long list of awards here, including the prestigious MacArthur Genius Fellowship Award. And finally, we have Stan Williams. Stan has a long history as a water resources manager. He's currently a vice president with Poseidon and had a lead role in the Carlsbad office and on the project, which he'll speak a little bit about. He served prior to that for 13 years as the chief executive officer for the Santa Clara Valley Water District and has a lot of experience gained through that in large capital infrastructure projects. So with that, I'd like to ask that Ron Davis come forward and provide us with his presentation, and then we'll cycle through the presentations from there. Here you go, Ron.
Thank you very much, Alex. Hello, everybody. Ready to rock and roll about something really exciting? Yeah, right. Okay. We got this up. Okay, if we could go to the next slide, please. We'll get through these fairly quickly. The clicker? Oh, I'm going to do that. Okay. So Alex did a really nice job kind of outlining the issues. What am I pointing at, John?
Well, if we have power on that way.
Is it on? Who am I pointing at? There's am I pushing the right button?
If I do it, go ahead. There you go.
All right, sir. Ah. See, I'm a liberal arts major. I'm not a technical person, as I demonstrate that. Okay, as Alex mentioned, Desalination is not one of your statewide water issues. It's a local or regional water supply issue, and that's become more important for areas in the state of California in light of some issues that the State Water Project and the Central Valley Water Project have had to deal with in terms of regulatory drought, actual droughts, and a number of other service problems. It's also been a way to address, meeting the fish requirements and the growth requirements of the state of California. So in order to meet the changes since the building of the state and federal water projects in the last century, water managers throughout the state of California have had to work out other ways to make sure that they can make sure they have a sufficient and adequate water supply for those who pay them rates. And that is going to be a key method of moving forward from now on. So they're going to have a water supply portfolio to pursue. And one of the options that certainly in the coastal region that can be pursued is desalination. The real benefit of desalination is that it does provide a very reliable supply. It doesn't suffer from the notion or the risks of regulatory drought once you've got it up and running. It provides a great deal of value in terms of meeting the needs locally. So the question then becomes, what's the value and how much would your ratepayers be willing to pay for a reliable supply? So the benefits for investing in reliability are not only are conservation and recycled water valuable for demand side management, but desalination is valuable because it is one of the few water supply options that is drinkable. It fits right into the municipal drinking water system. It also addresses, as I mentioned, the regulatory drought and provides reliability there. Helps in the event that DWR is predicting the potential possibility of a 6.5 earthquake in the Delta. In the event that you have a collapse of the system, you could use desalination to shore up that loss of water supply. It also provides environmental benefits in that most traditional water supplies now are very stretched. And as a result, if you can develop a desal facility, provide new water supply in a local region, then you can leave more water in those traditional water supplies for purposes of allowing fish and wildlife to have a better supply and meet their needs. But as Alex mentioned, energy is a key cost driver for desal. There's no question about that. However, the benefit of finding more natural gas in the United States has resulted in the price of natural gas dropping dramatically since 2008-2009. Yesterday, Senator Pavley's SB4, her measure to regulate the fracking process in California, was approved, and the governor has already announced that he will sign that bill. So there will be regulations for fracking in California, but it does not prevent fracking like several other bills that would have been looked at by the legislature this year. They were all held. So the potential for lower price natural gas is very valuable. The key thing, though, is that the desal industry is going to need to be very efficient with water and needs to continue to pursue finding new membrane technologies for purposes of reducing their power use, using energy recovery devices, and maximizing opportunities to use renewable energy when it's fair and appropriate. One of the things I was going to share with you today, and I'm going to spend a little more time on what's going on in terms of the future of desal. A very important process is occurring at the State Water Resources Control Board right now. This process has been going on for about 2.5 years. California has the California Ocean Plan that is managed by the State Water Resources Control Board. We have the chair of the board up here, so she's going to be watching what I say very carefully. So just let me say for the record that since she's here, this has been the finest regulatory process that I have ever been participating in. And actually, I do have a lot of nice things to say, so I don't want to take anything away from how I believe the staff has pursued this process. Because I started, like Alex said, 2.5 years ago or so, literally 1 month after I got hired, the Water Board announced that they were going to start their triennial review, amending the ocean plan, and they were going to talk about, and the three principal issues are going to be desalination issues. And they happen to be intakes. Currently, the state water desal plants are regulated by the NPDES permitting process. And the ocean plan and the Water Board's idea is to amend the ocean plan to establish three standards that are very important for managing and protecting the environment with respect to desal facilities. And that is intakes and mitigation. That would be one standard that's going to be added to the ocean plan. The other important one is brine disposal. For every gallon of water, every gallon of water you take out of the ocean, you put back a gallon that would have twice as much salt in it if you don't figure out a way to disperse that properly, diffuse it with either mixing it with other wastewater or using, the word just escaped me, but there's, diffusers, thank you very much, to make sure that the water returns into the ocean with the same approximate same amount of salinity as it came out. The third thing is to set a salinity objective for purposes of meeting the safety and salt requirements to meet the habitat protection for the more sensitive fish and wildlife in the ocean. So they have been working through this process for about 2.5 years. Our first request to them was to make sure that they provide an open and transparent process to allow all stakeholders an opportunity to participate in the process as it goes forward. And this is where I really mean this, Madam Chair, is your staff has done a very good job, the board has done a very good job of providing stakeholders that opportunity. We've had 3 or 4 public stakeholder work groups meetings, if not more, every year. That was kind of, I was very pleased to see just recently that we had a couple of very important, shall we say, talking sessions with the staff, because as it turns out, the person who started this process retired and they needed to replace the staff. So a whole new set of staff have started working on this issue and they are catching up very rapidly. They're doing a great job. I'm still not sure how it's going to turn out. Of course, we don't know how that's going to turn out, but at least we're being given our fair opportunity to be heard, and we really appreciate that. And I believe the new staff has done a very good job catching up and opening up the conversation with those of us who are in the industry. So with that, I'm going to conclude my comments and turn it over to who's our next spokesperson? Or are you going to? Mr. Williams.
How did you do this thing?
Turn it the wrong way.
Which one goes where?
I think that one.
That's it? Oh, we already got a slide on, so that's okay. Good afternoon. I'm Stan Williams. Glad to be back in the Bay Area again. I haven't been here for a while. I moved down to San Diego about 2 years ago. I must say, moving from Silicon Valley, where I lived for about 20 years, to San Diego, the lifestyle is a little bit more laid back, and I really enjoy my new scenery and work. When I was in the Bay Area, I was involved a lot with working with the Bay Area water agencies and integrated water resource management planning in the Bay Area. In fact, I chaired the first group to put together the plan for that. So my hat, as it was with the Santa Clara Valley Water District, which has a lot of different functions, including groundwater and surface water and flood control and stormwater and you name it, even recycled water, was always trying to integrate within the district all those functions, and then at the Bay Area scale, all different types of water resources. So often I tend to talk and speak in terms of all the integration of all these factors and how they all work together. So I was given the role today of actually taking, I think, what it was called the doer perspective rather than the philosophy of how you integrate all these things. So I'm just going to talk about a specific project rather than desal in general. And I'm here today as a employee of a private company, Poseidon Water. And we're constructing, it's not in operation, it's under construction, the largest seawater desalination plant in the Western Hemisphere. It's in Carlsbad, California, which is the northern part of San Diego County. And it will, when constructed, provide up to 50 million gallons a day of drinking quality water. Now, for water people, 50 MGD, if you're in the water supply business, that's about 56,000 acre feet. If you're not in the water supply business, it's over 18 billion gallons a year. So it's a significantly sized facility. And Poseidon is a private company that specializes in developing these types of seawater desalination or wastewater related projects through public private partnerships. And the partnership structure for any particular project depends on, of course, where you're working and the nature of the public agencies that are involved. So Poseidon doesn't work just in California. We're also doing work in Florida and in Texas, for example. And they're all different. And in every place we work or think about working in California are different. But in this session, we'll see if we go this way. Again, I'm trying to present a project that has gone through the process. And the Alex gave some statistics from the 2009 water plan about desal in the state. My observation is that, at least in this century, there hasn't been a lot of actual construction of facilities in the state, and that the Carlsbad project is kind of the symbol of the first project that's kind of made it through the modern regulatory process. The transaction that brought about this particular project is a 30-year water purchase agreement between the San Diego County Water Authority and Poseidon, and it allows the Water Authority to transfer certain key risks to the private sector, to Poseidon, while supporting project financing at an investment grade level. And this capital structure for this project includes $756 million in tax exempt bonds issued by the California Pollution Control Financing Authority on behalf of both Poseidon and the Water Authority. It also includes the $167 million of private equity. And another $80 million in improvements to be made by the Water Authority to accommodate this new supply of water. Now, under this particular agreement, this water purchase agreement, which was negotiated over like a two-year period between Poseidon and the Water Authority, the authority pays only for a delivered product that meets its stringent quality standards. And what that does is ensures that Poseidon, the private party, has significant incentive to avoid construction delays, plant downtime, labor disputes, inefficiencies. These are all costs that Poseidon would have to absorb if they're incurred. And in turn, Poseidon sought to minimize its exposure by selecting very highly qualified firms with vast experience in large-scale infrastructure, I mean with desalination projects, that had histories of success and sufficient resources to support the accountability that we have with their contracts. Let's go to the permitting. So it could be a surprise, probably not. A project like this would have to go through a pretty long vetting process and a very extensive public review process. And which, for those of you who've been in the water industry for any length of time, no, that's not uncommon for any type of new water source, any type of water project. This particular topic was introduced as controversial. Alex said maybe, a new dam might be more controversial. I think all types of water source projects are controversial. I've never known any that weren't. New conveyance, I think, might be controversial in the Bay Delta situation. Surface storage obviously is, but groundwater storage can be controversial also, or how you manage the groundwater basin. So I think it's a very interesting way that people have described. In fact, the new update for the California State Water Plan, the staff assigned to write that particular section presented a draft recently in which they have a really detailed description, a technical description of how desalination is done, the various options and alternative ways to do the processes, very detailed. And when asked why they did that, when the other sections on other sources of supply don't really have that, they said, well, it's because it's so controversial and because people don't understand it. I don't think that's necessarily a correct assessment. I think that desalination generally, as shown in polling in San Diego County, at the public level, had a lot of support. I think like any other source of water, it has certain impacts, certain issues that have to be dealt with, and all those have their own contingency and representatives who argue their case for them. But this process that we're talking about essentially takes 2 gallons of seawater and converts it to 1 gallon of drinking water. And then 1 gallon of water with twice the salinity of seawater is the other product. That concentrated seawater, in our case, will be diluted before it enters the ocean in accordance with the environmental regulation and as approved by the Regional Water Quality Control Board. During the permitting process, Poseidon volunteered to account for and to reduce to zero the net indirect greenhouse gas emissions associated with the project. And this resulting plan that came about became a condition approval by the Coastal Commission. But the key elements of it are the state-of-the-art on-site energy minimization measures costing approximately $55 million, on-site solar, green building design, energy recovery in the plant, injecting recovered CO2 into desalinated water, $1 million toward reforestation of San Diego areas that were impacted by the 2007 wildfires, and then purchase of offsets and renewable energy credits sufficient to zero out the indirect greenhouse gas emissions. The price of desal is always an issue and question. As is its energy intensity. And the Water Authority did a couple of things, or a lot of things, in their due diligence, but they really compared the cost of the source of desal with other potential sources, and they evaluated the energy cost risk. They found that to varying degrees, energy use is integral to any source of supply, and based on its current operating plans, approximately 1/4 the cost of the desal water would be energy related. But that any increase in the price of energy would have an impact on them no matter what the source is or how they whether desal was part of that portfolio or not. And in fact, because of the predominance of imported water in the region's portfolio, increases in energy costs associated with imported supplies, particularly the State Water Project supply, would have the greatest impact on the total price. Their financial exposure to higher electricity prices now in the future would not be affected by adding desal to their portfolio, in that it only accounts for about 10% of their supply. So summarizing the project, it's got benefits that Ron has described already in terms of the general desal proposition. And again, the biggest, I think, advantage for the public agency involved in this is a transfer of the risk, the operating and construction risk of the project to the private sector and being able to utilize the private financing. So they come out of it without any bond debt. They go into the project only paying for water that actually is delivered and meets their standards. And that is my time, so I will be glad to pass it on and respond to questions.
Can you hear me?
Just please don't regret. When first speaker and first panel, Ben from Izbeimat, he'd been talking about that he saw a sign that 40% of the energy is wasted, and the Izbeimat Municipal Water District, Municipal Utility District did great job making the wastewater treatment almost neutral or neutral, just using that benefit that they have a hidden energy. So what I want to allude, I want to look that from inside of the energy consumption in desalination, and are we correctly spending energy, and do we waste energy when we desalinate the water? Those who are not very techy, and I just want to get back that today the commercial technology for desalination, actually we still have two major directions, thermal desalination and membrane desalination. On a thermal desalination, if you don't have a waste energy like in the Middle East, so the membrane desalination, which is basic technology reverse osmosis ORO, is actually the lowest energy demand for desalinating the water. So that's why when all talks you heard about that and all municipal projects that people consider in desalination that based on a desalination by reverse osmosis, it's a membrane desalination called. So if we will take a look at that energy, whichever we need spent for that membrane desalination, actually if you open that black box, we have two major components. We have a kinetic energy and we have an osmotic energy. And here's, I don't know if I picked the right ratio between the kinetic and the osmotic energy for the process, but the osmotic pressure or energy required for the desalinated water, that the most of the energy that we apply to the process. And practically what happened when we, it's that energy concentrated in the brine or concentrate from desalination plant. And that actually it's a byproduct and waste that we send it back to the ocean. We are not really using that beneficial or benefits of the gradients between receiving water and the concentrate. And if we go to the next slide, that typical picture, if you've probably seen that many times, it's how osmotic power works, or desalination by reverse osmosis. So it's actually we squeeze in the desalination as a terminology. Desalination is actually, it's not probably to say more correct, it's not salt removal from the water. It's really squeezing water out of the source water. So this is the desalination. So that's true for thermal processes. So actually what we're trying to do, we're extracting clean water from the source water, and that is true for the membrane processes. When we're squeezing clean water out of the source water, or seawater, ocean water. So what's interesting, if you'll take a look at the number at the very bottom, every 100 milligram of TDS, it's salinity, we express it that way, it's carry the pressure 1 psi. If you will take a look Pacific Ocean with the average salt content, about 35,000 milligram per liter TDS, it's already carrying 350 psi, just osmotic power. And when you build a system, the same like a Carlsbad that Stan presented, you need to reach the concentrate as the tail of the process close to 70,000 milligram per liter of salinity, which actually carry over the osmotic pressure up to 700 psi. So that is a huge pressure that we need to overcome when we're squeezing out the clean water. And when you build the plan, if you will take a look the numbers, and the numbers because our company designing that plan, so we look in the pressure, operational pressure, 850, 900 psi and so on. So actually bulk of the, major bulk of the energy is hidden or stored in that concentrate, which is discharged through the diffusers back to the ocean. And that is just schematically any desalination process components has. So a half of the cost of the water is hidden in the energy. And probably 80 or even more percent of that energy we still as a waste we throwing out back to the ocean. So actually, if we were to look at the membrane desalination process, actually that would be true to thermal desalination as well. So practically we can look at the brine or concentrate from desalination plant as a battery. As a battery in our car that stored that osmotic pressure. And we should to recover it. If we will take a look at the development of desalination by membrane desalination, the by reverse osmosis, from the very beginning that started early 60s, actually the process been improving, and we had a certain jump when we tapped, actually, or industry found that red arrow the up, when industry tapped the energy kinetic or part of the kinetic energy that supplied to the reverse osmosis process and comes back from the concentrate. And that by introducing to the market in mid-90s, early 90s, the energy recovery devices, which now it is standard as a default law. And after that, there is a lot of new technology coming in. However, they are not very much commercial at that point. So we're still looking for certain jump to in the desalination industry to overcome that energy demand. And most likely that will be somewhere in the area when we can remove or return back that osmotic energy that today most of the desalination plant, including all in the construction, actually throwing out back in the to the ocean. So actually that battery that holds that energy, it's thrown back to the ocean. It's, the idea is not new, and idea being known, it's what coincidentally, the processes they are returning that concentrate, they called sometimes forward osmosis, sometimes pressure retarded osmosis. So they known, and they were actually developed by the same gentleman who developed reverse osmosis process. Reverse osmosis process been, as I already mentioned, been developed early 60s, and actually the pressure retarded osmosis concept has been patented in 1972. However, it started to attract attention just within last 5-7 years as the crisis, the oil crisis came in. So when we were paying less than $1 for a gallon of gas, no one been looking at that. But now it's a different time. So by combination of those processes and recovering the energy from the concentrate, that what can be really the next wave and breakthrough in the energy saving in the reverse osmosis. And I hope will come the time that we will be talking about not a high energy tack for desalination, but neutral, really the neutral desalination processes. Thank you. Peter Glick next.
Thank you. Can we get the lights? I actually have no slides, which could be a good thing or a bad thing. We'll see. I'm Peter Glick from the Pacific Institute. The Institute is a research institute over in Oakland. We work on water issues broadly. We've done a lot of work on water and energy and water and desalination. Alex started this by saying the panel had full perspective on desalination. I think that's not right. I don't think this panel has anywhere near the full perspective on desalination, especially if I'm supposed to be the non-industry representative, for reasons I'll come to in a moment. The Institute has done a series of reports on desalination, looking at energy issues, financing and cost issues. We're about to issue another one on environmental impacts on brine disposal and salinity and those sorts of things. But why are we having a separate panel on desalination? I throw that out there sort of rhetorically, but seriously. Why not instead a special panel on wastewater or low flow toilets or whatever? Why desalination? What is it about desalination that is so special? Is it that it's a silver bullet to our problems? 97% of the world's water is salt water. If we could just get that salt out, wouldn't that solve all our problems? And of course, desalination does that. It takes the salt out. Is it because it has unusual energy requirements? And this is an energy water discussion, set of discussions. Is it because it's a disruptive technology? Well, it's been around for a long time. They've been desalinating water for 100 years and in bulk in the Persian Gulf or Arabian Gulf for decades. Is it because it's big engineering projects? And gee, we like big projects in the water world. Is it timely? Because Carlsbad has finally gotten through the process. It's under construction. It's going to be the first, assuming it gets completed, the first really big modern desalination plant in California. Maybe it's all of those, but I'm not sure, because I'm not sure that desalination ought to be treated any different than any other of the suite of things, the portfolio, as we've been putting it in the water world for a while, of options for water in California that are available to us. I'm not going to talk about Carlsbad, no doubt to the relief of some over there. Although maybe during the question and answer we can talk about that. So California has a complex mix of water sources with a very wide range of energy requirements. We have low energy in terms of energy per unit of water produced systems. We have high energy per unit of water produced kinds of systems. We have a mix. California is a pretty complicated place. We built a very sophisticated system to move water from one place to another. There are energy costs to that we didn't care about maybe 50 years ago that we do care about now. We have a complex mix of energy sources as well with water requirements, and we heard some about those issues earlier. We have a growing need to cut greenhouse gas emissions. That's part of the reason why the energy-water nexus is such a big discussion now, because we realize that climate change is a real problem and that greenhouse gas emissions have to be cut, in addition to, in the longer term, thinking about unavoidable adaptation to climate change. And our water systems play a role in that. So we're trying to understand the energy requirements of our water systems. We're trying to understand the ability to provide the water we need with less energy or with fewer greenhouse gas emissions associated with that energy. And yet we also have this conflict because we think there's going to be a greater demand for water. Can we increase the water services and the water perhaps to a population of 50 million people without increasing our greenhouse gas emissions? This is the dispute. This is the difficulty. This is the discussion that I think we're having, that we've been having all day and that we're having more broadly. Does it make sense to build energy-intensive water systems, and desalination is an energy-intensive water system, when we're in this greenhouse gas reduction, energy reduction debate at the same time? That's part of the conflict, I think, that we're having. There is enormous opposition to desalination, and I'm not the one, I'm not the one who should represent that opposition. There should have been somebody here from some of the environmental groups to explain some of that opposition more clearly. But it's associated with some of the things I've already discussed. It's associated with environmental concerns, with energy concerns, with cost concerns, with size concerns, with coastal impact concerns, with whether or not we're evaluating desalination on an equal footing with conservation and efficiency and other supply options like treated wastewater. And I think those are fair questions, and I don't think they've been fully resolved. And that's part of the conflict and competition and controversy over desalination. I do think there's a role for desalination in California's water portfolio. I do think we're going to see more and more desalination in California over time. I do think it ought to be done right. And I will say, maybe to be provocative, that I don't think it's been done right. Okay, I said I wouldn't pick on Carlsbad, but I'm going to. I think the Carlsbad project was not done right. And I actually think there's great desalination out there. And I think, as I've said, I think there's going to be a lot more of it in California's future. But I think our experience so far hasn't been good. And I think that's been a bit of a problem. And we better learn how to do it right if it's going to be a bigger and bigger part of our portfolio. So in the future, here's some observations. It's expensive. I don't see it getting cheaper. In fact, I see it getting more expensive. And you saw the numbers, the official numbers right now are $2,000 to $2,300 an acre foot for Carlsbad. That's gone up from the original estimates of $700 or $800 an acre foot or $900 the original when the project was first proposed. That's really expensive, and I don't see it getting cheaper. There's been a lot of technological advance in the last couple of decades to reduce the energy costs of desalination. But there are limits to that as well. We've captured a lot of the energy, and as Val talked about in the last talk, there's still potential to reduce the energy cost of desalination somewhat, but not a whole lot. And energy is expensive, but capital infrastructure is expensive as well. And you have to run the plant at full capacity all the time, or that dollar per acre foot number goes up even higher, as they've discovered in Australia. There are advantages of desalination that are not economic or not captured by the economics. And we did hear a little bit about this as well. There is a real value to a reliable source of water that's drought proof. California is vulnerable to droughts. We're in one now and we're worried about next year. Desalination doesn't have that vulnerability. There is a real advantage to a reliable source of water south of the Delta. Now, building the desalination plant in Carlsbad doesn't mean they're going to cut withdrawals from the Delta by 50 million gallons a day. San Diego's not promising that. Met's not promising that. So that's an issue as well. But there are these reliability advantages. There are other advantages of desal that aren't actually captured in the economics. And that's an important policy point as well. And there are other issues around coastal concerns. There are issues about public versus private. I won't raise them. Maybe we can talk about them in the end. But I do think it's part of our future. I would like to see it done properly and done well. And I would like to see it evaluated on an equal footing with other alternatives, such as, in particular, conservation and efficiency, that are equally reliable, equally drought-proof, and perhaps far more cost-effective at the moment. And with that, I'll leave it at that. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you, Peter. Excellent presentations by the panel. And I thank you all for providing me with quite a few good questions. So I'm gonna start out here, try to provide a question to each one of the panelists to sort of seem to fall nicely. You each get one. And then there are several questions that all of you will have an opportunity to answer. And I'll just provide you the courtesy of asking the questions in the order of which you made your presentations. So Ron, is there any indication that the State Water Board is considering site-specific salinity objectives for the California Ocean Plan Amendment?
They are considering that because the stakeholders that I represent are asking for that every time we chat with them. We think it's very important for the standards for all three of those important issues to be site-specific and localized to address the particular habitat that the facility is being developed in. And we're having an ongoing dialogue with that. That's still part of the decision-making process yet.
All right, you have your answer. All right, Stan, speaking about the Carlsbad project, contentious project, has part of the opposition to the project been specifically because of the public-private partnership aspect of the project? Would it have been less opposition if it had been advanced solely, say, by the San Diego County Water Authority?
Well, let me hedge a little bit by saying that I've just worked for Poseidon for the last 4 years, and of course, the Carlsbad project started out long before then. So I can't speak to the initial reaction of the public-private issue. I think it's come up with several other projects around the state, though, and there's always a discussion about, you know, the role of public versus private in water resource management. What I've come to learn, being now in the private sector, is I think there is a role for the private sector in water resource development, and that in particular, when you have something like desal where there is a lot of risk, there's a lot of upfront risk on the development cost, In our case, Carlsbad, there was over $60 million sunk in development costs before ever getting a water deal, and the years of work that it takes to get there. And that risk is considerable, and a lot of public agencies can't really withstand that kind of long-term investment into a project without having a better understanding that they're going to get a project that works. So I think that risk is a one that we've seen it in various places around the state where there's been interest in desal by public agencies, but they haven't quite been able to move the project to the actual development stage. They get caught somewhere along the line. They get sued enough times that they get tired of it, or there's enough reaction from the particular type of the public that they get tired of it. So it's very difficult to push one through, and I think that is a role the private sector can play. It's the one that has been done in Carlsbad and in the next project that we're working on in Huntington Beach. The key for the public agency, I think, is to make sure that the arrangement, the agreement that you're doing to get that reliable source of water protects the public and does it in such a way that the public still has a control over choosing what the source of water is in their particular area, and it's not something forced on them by either a private sector company or by a state agency in terms of directing some kind of loading order of water supply sources.
Well, thank you. Peter, you had talked a little bit, you referenced public-private partnership a little bit. Did you have anything to add to that question in terms of whether or not the fact that it was a public-private partnership caused it to be a less than perfect project or created to some of the controversy?
Well, I do think it was a part of the controversy. I do think there were certain people who were opposed to the plant because of the public-private because of the private nature of it. I'm sort of ambivalent about that. I also see a role for the private sector in water systems in lots of different ways. I do think some people have a problem with that. There also were problems associated with the risk sharing, public versus private risk. There were problems with, yes, I think that was part of it.
Okay, well, thank you. All right, I saw you there. I knew you wanted to talk about it briefly. Hey, Val. This is a technical question for you from the audience. Could you please describe briefly, because this could be like a whole separate presentation on its own, a few brine disposal techniques, and do you view that deep water desal is feasible from an environmental, deep water disposal for brine is feasible from a financial and environmental perspective? Big question.
Tough question, yeah. How much time I have for to answer?
You have less than 2 minutes.
Less than 2 minutes, okay. Well, okay. First of all, as I alluded, the most of the energy that we spend it for desalination still sits in that brine. I haven't seen really the solid study, and I looked at everywhere. What's the difference how brine with the highest salinity than the receiving water affecting the environment comparing to the wastewater treated discharge with low salinity to the higher salinity. So that's why many plants, they're considering the blending and to bring, so the overall concept, the idea, what actually the industry doing, they're trying to match salinity of the receiving water but different blending, or like Carlsbad, the bypass, to mitigate the difference between the receiving water salinity and discharge brine, the concentrate. So that's where the whole industry head into. What I see the benefits really when you merge both through the pressure retarded osmosis technique that been patented in 1972 but been not really implemented. Just one project been built in the Statkraft in Norway in 2009. The industry didn't look very deeply to get all benefits of the energy recovery from desalination process and mitigated the environmental impact. Okay, if I answer that question.
I think that was pretty good. Everybody agree? Yes, thank you. Good try, 2 minutes or less. This is a question from the audience that I'm gonna sort of generalize a little bit so that you might have a better chance at answering it, and that is, is the technology available, or are there systems available that can be ramped up very quickly to allow desalination in the case of emergencies or water supply disruptions to be a viable emergency supply. I mean, I could answer this, but you guys are the panel, so.
Yeah, I can speak of that.
Yeah, go
technical.
Ahead.
It's not a political question. Okay. It's easy. Okay. Definitely there is a lot of prepackaged mobile system emergency for military, and I use design many of those too. And however, they are not on large capacity. If some disaster happen, like if we will, I hope that will not happen soon, but the earthquake or tsunami in California, and any water supply interruption on the city size. So I think it's quite challenging. So you need too many of those units. They still are on a very limited capacity. They're available, they're known, they were supplied for too many emerging after the same like Katrina event on the Haiti. There's number of units we supplied, yeah, but it's not on the scale of the large community supply.
Thank you, Val. So I open this one to whoever feels that they're in a best position to answer it. In the paper today, we saw that there was a recent Supreme Court ruling on the Marin desal project, and that ruling they basically overturned the challenge by the environmental advocates, and so now the project is in a position where it can proceed. And I wondered, what do you see? Do any of you have any thoughts about the future implications of that ruling?
The Marin Municipal Water District is pursuing that court decision to make sure that they preserve their ability to move forward with that project. As a result of the economic downturn, their sales have gone down dramatically in terms of water sales. So the need for the project, which just a couple of years ago was within the next 5 years, is now pushed out a little bit. So it's more a matter of the court decision there. This is the second decision they've won this year. They won the first appellate court decision earlier in the spring after a local judge had ruled in favor of the environmental community that the environmental document did not demonstrate no environmental damage. It was also an interesting case because the judge argued that the cost of conservation was nothing, so that they should be pursuing free water. I'm not sure I've ever heard of that before. But the decision has been overturned twice now. The lower court decision has been overturned twice now, and as I understand it, Marin Municipal is preserving their legal rights to move forward at the time that their water supply plan would require them to move forward with the actual facility, which is now going to be pushed back a little bit.
Well, thank you, Ron. I'd like you to hold the mic because there was a question that I heard about earlier today, and I know you have the answer. So can you help us appreciate where the funding is for desalination in the water bond?
The water bond and the one that's on the ballot that the legislature is looking at removing, there is funding for both salinity management and seawater desalination in Chapter 11, if I remember the number correctly. That's the chapter for recycled water, $1 billion, and among the eligible projects would be salinity management and desalination. Mr. Rendon's version of the water bond that's in the legislature carries over that language, but the amount of money is half. So it's only $500 million, so it spreads out a little much thinner. Right. And so, needless to say, water reuse, we'll be urging that number to go up, and we'll be shoulder to shoulder with them, trying to see if there's any way we can get the amount in Mr. Rendon's AB 1331, the assembly water bond proposal, to see if there's any way we can increase that funding for important water supply options.
Thank you, Ron. Can you pass it to Peter? One more individual question. So, Peter, you spoke a little bit, or used the term, you know, great desalination, and I was wondering maybe if you could expand a little bit on how those who look towards desalination as part of their portfolio could improve the the perception of desal or how they approach desal so that it's more palatable to the environmental community.
Well, again, I'm not going to speak for the environmental community,
right.
And I'm not sure what the environmental community is. It's a diverse community,
right.
Like any community. But in general, the answer is address the problems associated with desal. The concerns are proper disposal of brine. Technologically, we can dispose of brine properly. It's an added cost to do it right. Proper intake design, proper coastal protection, proper balancing of your portfolio so that you're not buying more expensive water when there's less expensive water to be had. I'm a fan of the portfolio, but not necessarily at the cost of the pocketbook of the consumer. Proper analysis of the energy implications and proper carbon reduction requirements. They built a big desalination plant in Perth, Australia. They did a really good job with brine disposal, but they also built 80 megawatts of wind turbines to help provide the electricity for that RO plant. Proper transparency on financing. A lot of the concern about some of the recent proposals have been a lack of transparency about financing options and risk allocation. So there are a lot of pieces to any project. Frankly, you could take the word desalination out of this and put power plant or industrial plant and have the same kinds of concerns. You want to deal with the environmental community financing issues in a satisfactory way.
Thank you. I'm going to open these up to anybody who wants to answer them. This question is from new to the podium here is there any opportunity to use the remaining high salinity brine for salt making? Or could the brine be pumped into a salt harvesting facility for salt production? What are the concerns associated with consumption of brine residuals? Val?
Yes, theoretically, but probably not feasible practically. And those intents were made in a WD2 project in the Middle East in the past. So the problem is with the salt that the cost of the salt is relatively low compared to transportation. So if you have a consumption of that salt produced, and we're talking about a big number, it's really hard to eat whole or consume whole that salt at that place. If you plug in the transportation cost, it doesn't become economical. If there are no subsidies, so actually, three projects that we initiated, they all failed because of economics.
Thank you. Salt is generally pretty cheap, right? So it's hard to. So some general questions. If you had a word of advice for agencies considering desal, what would it be? And you guys can all have a shot at this one, so since you've all come at it from different perspectives.
Well, it would be, again, as Peter described, the same for any source of water for public agencies or private. The evaluation is hard to make because each water agency has their historic water sources that they've learned to live with the flaws of over time and made a lot of investments to protect. If we had to go back and do for other sources of supply what we're doing for desal, for example, to completely offset all of their environmental impacts up front and every effect they have, we wouldn't have very many sources of water. So in developing alternative sources going forward, though, I think it is a question of going through the options that are available in the region you're in and deciding which ones meet the particular objectives you have. So where there is a high need for water supply reliability, where you are subject to seismic issues, where you're subject to drought, where that impact, if you are not able to produce water, has substantial risk, which have substantial cost, then you can weigh alternatives to meet that. And in that scenario, for example, desal often makes sense, as does advanced recycled water and a lot of other options. And what's happened in the Water Authority in San Diego is they did look at those options and decided what mix should desal be of that portfolio. It's about 7%. CUA agencies, the California Urban Water Agencies, Alex, you're familiar with them, the largest urban agencies that serve over 2/3 of the people in California, did a study of projected water demand and sources to 2030, I think. and desal came out about 6% in that analysis. So it's not, you know, a panacea. It's not the thing that's going to save California's water supply. It's a piece. But the water agencies always have to decide what makes most sense in their particular area based upon their analysis of balancing risk of price increases for water versus drought versus price increases for energy and how they meet all those competing demands. That's the fun of being in the water business.
Alex, can I add to previous question, one exception?
Yes, please.
On assault, yeah. One interesting exception on assault instruction from a water could be actually the salt ponds by Cargill in the Bay Area. Because it's just different production, and what can be done that built to desalination plant and feed those ponds by the concentrate, so they really let Cargill, if those ponds still will be ongoing, start not from the bay water, 5 to 30,000 milligram per liter concentration, but starting from 70 to make smaller the ponds and make the production and have a drinking water supply in the area, like Redwood City on that place. On those.
We're trying to get rid of those ponds.
Right.
I was
right.
going to say, that won't be controversial at all.
Yeah, but now you're facing not technical question, right?
Peter, would you like to say anything in terms
well,
of advice?
You know, in part, this plant in San Diego is, the nickname for this plant down in San Diego is the I Hate Met plant. There's a value to San Diego not to buy water from Met, and I don't know how you put that into the price of dollars per acre foot either. But the short answer is a clear regulatory process. I do think Carlsbad sort of got caught up in the fact that there wasn't really much experience at the regulatory level in dealing with all of the different aspects of permitting a big plant like this, and maybe it'll be easier next time around. I'm not sure, but a clear regulatory process would be a help to any of these projects.
Ron, anything to add in terms of advice?
I would follow along Stan's arguments or line of logic. Trying to think through, for a local water manager to think through the water supply portfolio for the service area they're providing water for, they've got to look into a lot of different issues. And you're establishing now new water supply over and above, as he said, the historical water that they have been using for their service area for a number of years. So when you look at the price of desal, it is expensive compared to traditional supplies. But if you're also looking at, as Stan said, San Diego evaluated other supply options. I have another example. West Basin Municipal Water District is very aggressively recycling water. They recycle water at 5 different levels of water quality. They like to refer to it as designer water. And each of those run very close to the cost of a desal plant that they're also looking at. If they pursue, and they're going to pursue both, they're already recycling water at the 5 different levels. If they pursue a 10 MGD desal facility, the price of this recycled water is about the same. If they go to a 20 MGD desal project, because they're looking at both of them, it's actually desalination is a little less than the recycled water that they'll be using. The advantage, again, as I mentioned in my presentation, is that desalinated water is drinkable, and we haven't quite gotten over the hump for We haven't been allowed to drink direct potable water yet. So right now, recycled water is a demand management technique. Conservation, a demand management technique. Desalination is a water supply issue.
That's probably the subject of a whole nother panel, the transition from direct potable desal to direct potable reuse. Let's thank all of our panelists. Thank you.